ask most people, what do they wish for the last chapter of their life? And what most people will say is, they hope it comes at the end of a long and happy life. And they hope it happens at home, surrounded by the people who love them. And they hope that they're free of pain and fear. And for the majority of people, it turns out not to be what they get. In the United States, for instance, over 60% of people die in hospitals, not at home, even if they tried to ask to have that arrangement made. And when they're at the hospital, the opposite of that surrounded with the familiar and the loved ones, right? Think of the times you've been in a hospital, incredibly disorienting, right? Nothing familiar about it. People bustling in and you get to know one nurse and then another one comes on call. In one of the most, compelling studies that I've read, a bioethicist by the name of Dan Salmazi did an amazing study where he went into a hospital and, with the permission of patients, put a camcorder at the side of the bed, right at eye level, to capture what a patient sees in the bed as they lay dying. He ran the camcorder until death and afterwards, and then reviewed the footage from dozens of patients. And he said, reviewing that footage was one of the saddest moments of his life, for what he saw as he looked from the patient's perspective was an empty room. 90% of the time, the patient was alone. And this isn't because the healthcare providers weren't caring, it's because it's an institution, right? So what people want is to be at home, but they're at the hospital. What they want to be is surrounded by loved ones, but they're surrounded by strangers, and sometimes not surrounded at all. Why does this happen if so many of us want something so basic as a good death? Why does medicine so often get in the way? Well, one of the issues is a really fascinating issue that medical anthropologists talk about, which is sort of the culture of medicine, again, in many countries. When you ask medical care professionals what their mission is, right, it's to save lives. But the metaphor that's used often turns out into a kind of warrior-like one, that the culture is to battle death. Now, think about what that implies, right? It's got a good side and a bad side. The good side is that when we can save your life, right, that's awesome. You want that warrior by your side and not giving up on you, right? But when it becomes clear, or should become clear, that we're moving to not whether you'll die, but how you'll die, having a warrior who identifies with death as failure is not who you want at your side. So doctors, as a gross generalization, but still as a true generalization, are incredibly aversive to death. But if the culture is aversive about death, that sets up a really bad scenario. So often, patients who want to be, as it were, shepherded through to the transition from we're trying to keep you alive to let's talk about how to die, right? Where you're not going to be abandoned. And you will be surrounded by loved ones, and we will be here to take care of your pain and to make sure that you're not afraid as much as possible. What a friend of mine who's a hospice volunteer calls a midwife to your death. Just like the other bookend of life. We need help. I mean, think of it this way. When you're dying, you've never done it before, right? So don't you think you might need somebody who has some experience with how to do what you might expect, what's gonna happen? And the family, often, at least in many countries, we don't die at home, so it's new to the family as well. So to have somebody who's aversive about death isn't what you need. Now, some physicians and nurses are wonderful about this, especially people in the palliative care movement, which has grown leaps and bounds, fortunately. And they often are trying their hardest to get the patient and the family often to acknowledge and understand and make that transition to now we're talking about making this a good death, okay? And they find the patients or the family pushing back, right? That in the midst of fear and anxiety and being scared, they say, do everything. They don't want to give up hope, oftentimes because family think that giving up hope is somehow giving up caring, right? And they need the doctors and nurses to say, no, you still can care for your loved one, but what your caring looks like right now is not asking for more interventions. It's asking for support, surrounding, and help in dying. So here's a question. Should physicians be allowed to help hasten your death if you're terminal and that's what you want? So some people have argued, and actually very eloquently, that death is one of the most important chapters of your life. You should have dominion and a say over that chapter as much as any other. What do you think? Well, lots of interesting questions. What's the public policy implications of allowing physicians to do this? Do we worry about people being pressured to make the decision by family members who may be at their wit's end and exhausted, right? We also might wonder whether it's part of what medicine is about, right? So some people have said the telos, or the purpose or aim of medicine, shouldn't be to include death. Okay. Remember, it's to battle. But some people have argued that sometimes death itself could be a good. Again, not for those of you in the audience, but for people at the very end of their life, that that's actually part of helping somebody. Fascinating controversy. Well, let me move to the final example I wanted to put on the table here, which is what happens when people disagree about what death with dignity looks like, and the person in question can't speak for herself. Okay. So here's a heartbreaking case. Jahi McNath, a 13-year-old, last December, Oakland, California, went in for a routine tonsillectomy and tragically suffered cardiac arrest on the operating table, lost blood flow to her brain, and became brain dead, which means no brain activity. There's a question about futile care, the hospital argued. That is, there's nothing we can do for Jahi, very, very sadly, so let's stop what is surely only a burdensome form of technology, the ventilator. Well, but who defines futility? If her parents thought that just continued life itself is a value, then the ventilator is actually highly effective at doing that. So whose values here determine? Just some examples to give an indication of why one of the most fascinating areas of bioethics looks at the end of life and how it intersects with the ends of medicine. Thank you.